afternoon or good evening. It's a pleasure once again to share God's holy word with you. I trust you've had a very good beginning in the year 2019. You know, usually I trust God for a vision for the year. But this year I prayed much, and I don't want to be presumptuous, but I must be honest enough to admit that I got no aims or goals for this year. All I want to do is to do the will of the Lord. And as the Lord leads me throughout the year, that will be my goal and desire for the moment. It's been a good year last year. God had seen us through. There were difficult moments, but nevertheless, Ebenezer, hitherto hath the Lord helped us. Before I commence this year's ministry, let our dear brother Ian Sinclair say a few words of greeting. Come over, Ian.
Hi, Calvary Apostolic Ministries, Calvary Evangelical Ministries. It's Ian Sinclair here. I would just like to thank you very much for those of you who prayed about my eye operation in November. Yes. It was a great success, and the eye operation went well. I had a detached retina, and also I had some scar tissue at the back of my eye. And the surgeons did a wonderful job, and it is totally healed up now, and I can see well. So glory to God. So I'm looking forward to this year and looking forward to what God has in store for this ministry. And so without further ado, I will hand you back now to Joe.
For several years, we have concentrated on Calvary Apostolic Ministries. But this year, I'm hoping by the grace of God and by the power of the Spirit to concentrate on Calvary Evangelical Ministries, though I must admit that the preaching will not always be evangelical. It will be, in a sense, teaching, evangelism, and also, in a sense, apostolic. But I will just do my best, because my emphasis would be towards the unsaved. Now, I want to do most of my evangelical preaching and even teaching and apostolic work from the book of Genesis. There's so much we can glean from the book of Genesis. And pray for me and Ian that God will give us the insight and the foresight to wait upon him and to hear from the Lord. Please keep Ian also in prayer. His operation was a success, but they also discovered of late that he still has a small problem with his eye, and he's going to the doctors this week or next week to determine just what is the problem.
Next week.
So please pray for him. And okay, and oh yes, please pray for Mrs. D. She's not always well, but she's a strong Christian that doesn't give in to sickness. Pray for her also, because she's been outstanding in regards to supporting this ministry prayerfully and financially. As you well know, Calvary Apostolic Ministries, Calvary Evangelical Ministries, teaching ministry do not solicit funds. We trust God. My wife supports my ministry, and then I work. I work 3 days a week to support this ministry financially. And oh yes, I've got to thank my dear friend, Pastor Glenn Horner, who sent us a gift financially for the running of our ministry. So, Pastor Glenn Horner, thank you so much for your gift. We pray God's blessings upon you in Jesus' name. Now, let's get into it. I'm taking my reading this morning from the book of Genesis. And that is chapter 1, verse 26. And I'm reading from the English Standard Version. Then God said, let us make man in our image and after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over the livestock and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God he created him. Male and female he created them. Amen. Just a small addition. Please note that both Adam and Eve were created in God's image and likeness. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we come to you in the never-failing name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It's our desire, O God, to glorify the eternal Godhead, Father, Son, and Spirit. And God, we know the greatest way that we can do it, other than living a Christ-like life, is to preach the gospel. O God, to feast off the word of God. Help us, God, as we share God's word, that first and foremost, that Ian and myself and Mrs. D will live according to God's word. Let the word of God be a double-edged sword in our life. Before it ministers to the hearers, let it minister to us, O God, in Jesus' name. Bless this ministry. Bless the hearers, O God. Touch them, touch their families. Heal the sick, O God. And make the people that hear this word share God's word with those that know you not. And I pray it in Jesus' name with much thanksgiving. Amen. What to you is the greatest blessing God has afforded to man? No doubt, there can be many answers. First and foremost, like most of us, salvation is the greatest gift bestowed to man. Then some might say, no, I've got a good marriage and I must thank God for my good marriage. Some might say, oh, God has blessed me with a brand new home. Someone might say, no, God has blessed me with a brand new car. No doubt, we can go on and on with many varied answers. But no doubt, the greatest gift to me is salvation. The gift of God that defies all gifts. Salvation, yes, the born-again experience given to all those who accept Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. Salvation entails so many facets of blessing. Number one, there's reconciliation back to God our Father through the forgiveness of sins. Our record of sin is erased, no more remembered by God. There's no record of our sin if we accept Jesus as our Savior through salvation. Then number three, we become citizens of the household of God. And I remember in the land in which I was born, in southern South Africa, during the years of apartheid, all the people, all the citizens of South Africa, their names were not recorded on the register, the citizens voting register. But thank God, when it comes to God, every name, regardless of the ethnicity, is recorded in heaven as a citizen of the household of God. Let me share what to me is the second most outstanding blessing that God has afforded me. And this is it. The power of reproduction. The God-given miraculous power to reproduce after my own kind. The gift of reproducing my image and likeness. The Bible says in Genesis 1 that God decided to create man in his own image and likeness. In other words, in simple words, a replica of himself. And just how did God create man? The Bible speaks of a twofold creation. From the dust of the earth, man was formed. But yet, though formed, yet was he lifeless. Life only came after God inbreathed into the lifeless form of Adam the breath of life, the very kiss of life. The result of God's kiss of life is that man became a living soul. Now notice, man was formed, amen, from the dust of the ground. There was the physical shape of man. But man only became a living soul after that God had inbreathed Adam. After the breath of God, the kiss of life, man became conscious. Man became alive. Amen. Man's first encounter of life itself was God himself. Imagine opening your eyes, and there before you is the creator of heaven and earth, the infallible God, the all-powerful God, the omnipotent God, the omniscient God. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, praise God. He opened his eyes and he beheld the grandeur and the splendor and the majesty of Almighty God. What an introduction. His first encounter of life was the very, very, very view of his God who had created him, and that creating him in his own image and likeness, created after God himself. The kiss of life was more than an impartation of life. It was an impartation of God himself. God inbreathed God into Adam. It was the very life of God, the very being of God, flooded the being of Adam. Adam and God, through the breath of God, became one. Hallelujah! Adam was filled with God, and nothing less and nothing more. The fullness of God inhabited Adam. Please excuse my teeth. The once lifeless form was now filled with the life of God. No. Let me reword that. Adam was not just filled with the life of God. Adam was filled with the eternal life of God. Amen. With one major distinction though. God is from everlasting to everlasting. God is without beginning. God is without end. Man had a beginning, and that beginning began with the kiss of life. That beginning did not begin with the form that was before God, made from the dust of the earth. That beginning began when God breathed his spirit into man. And the Bible says God is a spirit, and therefore man was created in the image of a spirit being. What a statement. The eternal breath was inbreathed into Adam. God with no beginning and no end, and yet man has a beginning, but praise God, no end. Man has a beginning, but no end. And for this apparent truth, man's beginning was with the eternal God, and God who is eternal creates us in his image and likeness, and that of eternity. That of in eternity, rather. God, the author of life, eternity, eternal, created a being with eternity in mind. Man was never to be a time and a moment. Man was meant for eternity, fellowship with the eternal God, to become one with his God. Yes, a beginning, but praise God, my brother and my sister, an unsaved man without an end. I say this, my dear friend, and listen carefully. You can be born without God, but you can never die without God. Because though you die, yet you shall live, whether in hell eternally or in heaven eternally. Other than the impartation of eternity, God's kiss of life that was inbreathed into man was more than just eternal life. There was an impartation of the very character, the very nature, the very essence of God. And my Bible tells me that my God, who loves me and sent his only begotten Son to die for my sins, that I might be set free of sin, he breathed his very nature, his holiness, his perfection into Adam. Amen. God, who is without spot, without wrinkle, without stain, without sin, inbreathed his holiness. Hallelujah. His perfection into Adam. Hear what Psalm 99 says. The Lord is great in Zion. He is exalted over all the peoples. Let them praise his holy name. Leviticus 19:2. Speak to all the congregation. You shall be holy, for the Lord your God is holy. Other than being holy, God is love. And by the way, listen carefully, love is not God. God is love. And from this love that God inbreathed into Adam, his very nature of love, seasoned with that love, the fruit of all that love is the spirit of forgiveness, the spirit of kindness, the spirit of grace, and the spirit of mercy. Hallelujah. That's why we can't describe love. We can never describe love. Now, allow me to share just one more major blessing of God's image and likeness, which will bless you and I beyond comprehension. And this is it. Kingship. Let me reiterate it. Kingship. One more time. Make it a threefold cord that cannot be broken. Kingship. Which means dominion. Which means rule. Which means power. Hallelujah. Amen. The Hebrew word for dominion is radar. I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right. By the way, I'm not a Hebrew scholar, but I do word studies. And the word means to dominate, to rule, and to reign. Just as God has dominion, rule, and reign over his heavenly and earthly domain, God had blessed Adam to rule, reign over the earth and all its inhabitants. God is king and has a kingdom. He rules, he reigns in his kingdom. And all men are answerable to no one else but by God. For God swears by his own name. Like God, who has an eternal kingdom, God had made Adam an appointed king on earth. God is king in heaven and yet king over all his creation, but God appointed Adam as king of the earth. Notice what God had said. Let them have dominion, rule and reign over the earth. No wonder Adam named all the animals. They were subject to Adam, God's appointed king upon the earth. Amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Adam was given power, delegated authority to rule on earth. All on earth, listen to me, was accountable to Adam, who in turn was accountable to God. He had to give a report. Hallelujah. As God was king in heaven, man was king on earth. And yet Adam was a delegated king. He could not rule without God. God, our heavenly Father, created man in his image and likeness. And it seems as if God held nothing back from him. Nothing back from Adam. Creating Adam in his likeness and image. And giving him rule and domain. Just as God was a ruler. Adam was a ruler. But ruling in and through the power of God. Of God. Delegated power. Now, my spiritual application to all what I have said. Just as God has created in his own image and likeness, God has mightily blessed you and I with his delegated power to reproduce after our own kind. Now, what I'm saying to you is this. Next to salvation, I think the greatest blessing that God has afforded me is that I can reproduce after my own kind. Let me say this, whether you agree with me or not, God created, he reproduced after his own kind in Adam and Eve and in you and I, because we, like Adam and Eve, are created in the image and the likeness of a loving God who knows not sin, who is perfect in all his ways. Oh, hallelujah. By the way, man is a twofold creation. Like his God, who is a spirit being, man is a spirit being. Just as God became man in Jesus, thus God becoming physical, having a form of man, man is also a physical being created after Jesus Amen. Praise God. Now, let me say this. Man was created in the image and likeness of Jesus. Now, back to the spiritual application. What I believe is the greatest blessing outside of salvation that God has afforded to mankind. The power of reproduction, to reproduce after our own kind. It was as if God, after he had created Adam, was looking into a mirror when gazing upon Adam. For what God saw in Adam was nothing less than the image and likeness of God. God, who is eternal, breathed eternity into Adam. God saw an eternal creation. God, who is love, gave Adam the kiss of love. He inbreathed his loving nature. God saw love in Adam. Amen. God, who is holy, undefiled, without speck, without blemish, perfect in all his ways, breathed into Adam holiness, undefiled. Adam, listen to me, was perfect in innocence until he knew sin. But Adam was perfect in innocence. And then God had also breathed into Adam rulership. God made him the king of earth, just as God was king in heaven. Though God is king of all, the rule of Adam, the kingship of Adam, was under the domain of God's kingship. But wait, though we have no doubt this great blessing, we must never forget, and that blessing being once again the power of reproduction, that with every blessing afforded to you and I by God, we must come to the full realization that every blessing is accompanied with responsibility and accountability. What God has given to you and I regarding the image and likeness of God, we have to give an answer, an account of how we lived with that image and likeness. Simply meaning, we have to give a report to God how we handled the blessing of God. And that is why we have to fully understand the threefold responsibility of inbreathing our children with the power of God's reproduction ability and purpose. As God inbreathed Adam, so must we inbreathe our children. We must influence them with the character and the nature of God that is in you and I. God inbreathed Adam with his nature, his character, his essence. With this great blessing of reproduction, what are we going to do? Inbreathe our children with the great responsibility, amen, of living up to God's image and likeness. God pleads with you and I. God implores us that though God has given us this wonderful blessing, it comes with a responsibility. Yes, you see yourself in your child. Yes, I see myself in my children. But oh, that I might see God in them. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. We are called as parents to impart God's nature, God's character, God's holiness, God's eternalship to our children, and even the kingdom mentality. The big question, just how do we do that? Well, first and foremost, we don't do anything in our own strength, not through our own means. God never requires of us to accomplish his will and purposes without supplying the means to do what is required of us to conform our children to the image of God's Son. This is God's provision. God just doesn't expect us to reproduce Jesus in our children as God the Spirit is reproducing Christ in us without giving us the wherewithal. I've got no good thing in me that I could develop my children into the nature and character of Jesus Christ. I need the tools that come from God. I don't need the knowledge of man and the gifts of man. I need God to do God's work. And more so in my children. No wonder there's a saying that charity begins at home. Listen what I want to say now. There's a difference between a house and a home. Home where Jesus rules and reigns. Heaven on my earth where God is, there is home, there is heaven. Glory. God's provision for us to excel in imparting the character and the nature of God that possesses you and I is through His Word, which is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. Then also the example that we give as we live the life of Christ in the presence of our children. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise His wonderful name. Then, my dear friend, God has blessed us with the ministry of revelation, of how we can develop our children, not in a sense after our image, for our image is tarnished. Our image was spoiled. There's a record that is not good concerning you and I. But where God, Jesus Christ, is concerned, who possesses us and makes us the habitation of the Spirit and the temple of God, is without flaw. So my emphasis is not that my children take after my kind, but my children take after the kind of Jesus. Perfect. Hallelujah. Let me say this. Parenting is a gift of God, and yet it is a responsibility. But once again, God gives the threefold ability for you and I to develop our children after the image and likeness of Christ. There are three main ingredients that God has given and deposited into each one of us that will help us form and develop our children after Jesus. Number one, protection. Number two, provision. And number three, promotion. Let me say this again. Grab this into your spirit. And my brother and my sister, I don't boast in the Lord, but this teaching does not come from books. It comes from the very throne of God. Amen. My best sermons are those that God's given me personally. It doesn't mean I don't study. It doesn't mean I don't read. But let me say this. These sermons that I preach mostly is from God. I hear from God. I wait upon God. I shut myself off from the world, from my family, and I shut myself to be alone with God. The test of a man's soul is not how much he does for God. It's how much time he spends alone with God. Oh, hallelujah. No wonder you must read your Bible carefully, that in the midst of revival, God took Paul out of revival to shut him in jail so that he might be alone with God. Sometimes we get too busy for God. It's not being busy for God, it's being busy with God that counts. And the greatest miracles you will not see in your evangelical thrust. Your greatest miracles you will see when you are alone with God. God breaks the chains when we are alone with Him. Hallelujah. 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 Let me speak again of the threefold code of parenting. Protection, provision, and promotion. I'm going to stop there. I don't say that I feel the Spirit of God lifting off from me. But let me say this, my brother and my sister, child of God and not child of God. God is speaking to you. God is speaking to you. What is your greatest privilege that you have from God? My greatest privilege and honor that I have from God is to do exactly what God done. God created me in His image and likeness, and God gave me a similar blessing that I might reproduce after my image and my likeness. But hey, hear me now. There's no good thing in me, so I can't really reproduce after my own kind. I must die to myself and live unto Christ, that Christ might be seen in me by my children, and they might not emulate me, but rather they must emulate Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I close with this. We're going to talk next week about protection, provision, promotion, the three P's of parenting. Hallelujah. Those of you that have no children, that you are married now and you trust in God for children, this is how you must fashion your parental life. Those of you that have children already and you're married, maybe you made mistakes in the past, but you know what? It's never too late to begin afresh and anew. Take this teaching, take this evangelical apostolic teaching, and I tell you, my brother and sister, apply it to your home, and your home will no more be a house, it'll be heaven on God's earth. And you will develop children that will not only be a blessing to God, to the community, but to the world. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Let's pray, my brother and my sister. Oh, Church of God, please, 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 please. This is responsibility. Look here. Church does not begin in the church. Church begins at home. Church begins at home. Where mother and father teach their children the principles of God's word, who walk upright before them, that don't only preach the word, but live the word before their children. We must not only become living epistles to the world. First and foremost, we must be living epistles to our children. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus. And Father, be there the people that know not you as Lord and Savior. I pray through this word you will challenge them. You will quicken them. Let them know that God, you bestowed upon them a blessing that defies description. They are created in the image and likeness of God. And no doubt sin has robbed them of the image and likeness of God. But thank you for the eternal gift of the sonship of Jesus, who went to the cross of Calvary and died on their behalf and my behalf. And God, he said, it is finished. The power of evil is broken, and the image of God can be restored to us once again. I pray for every parent, O God, that has heard this word, that God, they will live by this word, O God, and let them know there are better things to come concerning this teachings and evangelical preaching and apostolic teaching, O God. O God, O God, I pray for every parent right now, in the name of Jesus, set yourself free by the power and through the power of the word to live a righteous life in the presence of your children. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Father, who are married now a few years and yet have no children, but God, when their children come, oh God, I just pray that they will be a blessing, oh God. I pray for my grandsons who have no children as yet, but you will bless them with children that will be men and women after Jesus' heart. Remember Anna and Kate also, God, my two granddaughters. Bless them, oh God, bless them. I pray for the church world, oh God. Help us to stop playing church, oh God. Help us, oh God, to realize that emphasis should not be in the church building. Emphasis should be in the home, because it's the home that influences the church and not the church that influences the home. We go with the blessings of God. We that are true Christians, we don't go for a blessing to church. We go with the blessing of God. We go with Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise your wonderful name. Bless him and myself, God. We've enjoyed this morning. Yes, we are tired and fatigued, but God, we look forward to greater things with the God who loved us and gave himself for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Today, this video will be up and running. You'll see it on Calvary Evangelical Ministries. Ian will put the link there. All we ask for you is your prayer. We don't want your money. We don't want your money. Because those that give often want to control. Amen. We don't want your money. All we want is your prayer. God meets my need and Ian's need. Though we struggle with great faith in your heart, knowing full well that this ministry is called of God, and God will supply our need. Not through man. God still rains bread from heaven. God still rains meat from heaven. Hallelujah. God bless you and have a good day. Hallelujah. Amen.